Taiwanese e-scooter brand Gogoro offering Filipinos a sustainable option to getting around without hurting their wallets. Gogoro Philippine CEO Bernard Liamzon says their two-wheeled smart vehicles hope to address two pain points in the transport sectors. Those are traffic congestion and soaring pump prices. He also shared the company's putting up more battery swapping stations across the metro for increased accessibility.
This is an entirely different technology. It is not a plug-in, it is a battery swap. And you can't charge the battery elsewhere. You need to go to a battery swapping station to get a fully charged battery. Competitive pricing will be there when it's compared to the internal combustion engine motorcycles, especially when you look at the total cost of ownership, which includes the acquisition cost of the vehicle, the maintenance, the gas. Overall, in total, it's actually less expensive to be able to maintain a two-wheel EV versus an ICE model.
The Philippines secures a fresh 30 billion yen loan from Japan aimed at helping disaster-hit areas recover faster from calamities. Signing the deal in Tokyo for the loan, which amounts to 11.6 million pesos, were Philippine Budget Secretary Benjamin Diokno and Japan International Cooperation Agency Senior Vice President Nakasawa Keiichiro. The loan will facilitate the swift recovery of areas after natural disasters by promoting policy actions on disaster risk reduction and management and strengthening disaster preparedness. Japan is the Philippines' largest official development assistance provider of loan and grant commitments. Tokyo also funded key railway projects in the country, like the North-South Commuter Railway Project and the Metro Rail Transit Line 3 Rehabilitation Project. Philippine debt payments almost double in the first half of the year. Data from the Treasury Bureau showed the Marcos administration paid 907.9 billion pesos of its obligations from January to June. That's 98% higher compared to the same period last year. A bulk of the debt service went to amortization or the settlement of the principal amount at 625.4 billion. Meanwhile, interest payments rose by 10% to 282.4 billion pesos. Aside from payment to local lenders, the Philippine government also settled 89.57 billion pesos in interests owed to foreign financiers in the first half. The Philippines' booming e-commerce sector expected to continue growing. The U.S. Department of Agriculture estimates total e-commerce sales in the Philippines to reach $24 billion. By 2025, with food and beverage accounting for a fifth of that total. The country's overall e-commerce sales are expected to grow at a compounded annual growth rate, or CAGR, of 9%. The report added half of the more than 70 million online users in the country participate in cross-border e-commerce. From just $1 million in 2022, purchases of food and beverage products through CBE could quadruple to 5 million in 2025. Among the top purchased products of Filipinos last year were food supplements, baked goods, chocolates, and pet food. The research arm of the Asia-Pacific Economic Cooperation, or APEC, sees growth in the region slowing down. It cites trade restrictions coupled with inflation and the lingering effects of El Nino. APEC study says the region's growth in the first quarter was at 3.9%, down from 5.8% in the same period last year. Data from the World Trade Organization shows the number of trade restrictive measures being enforced in APEC has reached 480 as of May. APEC's research unit, meanwhile, suggested that governments manage inflation and keep an eye on inflationary pressures, particularly on potential supply shocks such as extreme weather. Population growth in some Asian nations is seen to be a major driver of economic expansion. A report from Moody's Investor Service says population growth in South and Southeast Asia will significantly boost regional labor inputs and consumption. The Philippines is one of six developing Asian countries that's expected to account for one-third of the global population increase over the next two decades. Moody's says improved infrastructure development and government effectiveness has allowed the Philippines to facilitate stronger growth compared to peers such as Bangladesh and Pakistan. This, as it notes, population growth alone is not enough to achieve inclusive growth. Moody says better education and quality infrastructure also key to boosting economic expansion. Domestic production in the world's biggest selling car maker comes to a standstill due to a system malfunction. Toyota Motor Corporation halted operations across 14 assembly plants on Tuesday from a glitch that prevented it from ordering components. It says an investigation as to the cause of the malfunction is underway, but adds it's unlikely due to a cyber attack. Reuters estimates the plants account for a third of the firm's global production. Operations were halted for a day last year due to a cyber attack. Looking at Toyota's share price, it is down 0.2%, trading at 2,400 yen apiece. Washington's visiting Commerce Chief raises concerns over Chinese curbs on American chipmakers. Secretary Gina Raimondo discussed with her Chinese counterpart Wang Wentao Beijing's ban on sales on Micron chips and local regulators' non-approval of Intel's $5.4 billion acquisition of Tower Semiconductor. Raimondo says she also discussed with Wang China's curbs on gallium and germanium exports. She adds the U.S. and China agreed to start the exchange of information on export controls. Asian markets getting another lift this Tuesday. Regional equities are up as traders await fresh earnings reports from Wall Street and key economic data in the United States. Investors are also assessing the latest jobs print in Japan. Unemployment there came higher than expected at 2.7% in July. This was up from the 2.5% the month before that, which analysts had expected to stay still. A look now at the major stock indices in the region. The Nikkei 225 managing to post modest gains after unemployment slightly went up in Japan. Leading gains today are the Chinese markets, with tech stocks powering the rally. Let's take a look now at futures in Europe. They're pointing to a higher open this Tuesday. The British FTSE 100 seen to lead the gains as it resumes trading after a public holiday in the United Kingdom. Investors in the region are digesting the latest data, which shows lending growth to Eurozone companies slowing once more in July from higher interest rates. Over on Wall Street, stock futures are nearly flat as traders look ahead to the final days of what has been a heavy month for the market. Now for some local corporate stories. Double Dragon officially breaks ground for its Hotel 101 Niseko project in Japan. Leading the Hokkaido event was Double Dragon chair Edgar Injapsia II and co-chair Tony Tankaktyong. The hotel, to be built at the 1.17-hectare property, will have 482 rooms and is seen to be completed by 2026. This makes Hotel 101 the first-ever Filipino homegrown hotel chain to expand beyond the Philippines. Meanwhile, Eastern Communications inks a partnership with the ICT subsidiary of telco giant PLDT. The company says the deal will establish a point of presence in EPLDT's data center that's soon to rise in Santa Rosa, Laguna. The partnership is also seen to bolster Eastern Communications' operational capacity in disaster recovery. Finally, Sun Life gets regulatory approval overseas for the launch of its normal course issuer bid. The NCIB will seek to purchase close to 3% or 17 million common shares of the company's total 587 million. Sun Life adds this will enable it to return capital to shareholders as part of its overall capital management strategy.